And our first speaker is Ian Cheeseman, and he'll be talking about mapping the control of gene expression and malaria parasite genetic crosses.
Organizers for inviting me to give this talk today. So I'm going to talk through some a new tool that we've been developing, and hopefully by the end of this presentation, I'll persuade you that we have a robust tool that we can use to measure which genes control the expression of other genes in the parasite genome. So for this work, we rely heavily on malaria parasite genetic crosses. So these have a really rich and long history in malaria research that essentially began with this trio back in the 1980s. So here, this group took two very well-known, very well-established clones of malaria parasites, 3D7 and HB3, committed gametocytes, passed those through mosquitoes, where they recombined in the mosquito midgut and produced genetic recombinant progeny out the bottom, which firstly demonstrated that there was sexual recombination in the mosquito, but also showed that out the bottom of this, you can generate clonal recombinant progeny that you can use for genetic mapping. Now, this work relied heavily on using splenectinized chimpanzees, which is challenging for ethical reasons and logistic reasons. And this meant that essentially over about a 30-year time span, it was really only feasible to generate about 4 genetic crosses using this approach, which resulted in somewhere between 15 to 35 unique recombinant progeny that you can use for the actual genetic mapping. Now, about 6 or 7 years ago, we published a paper that essentially got round a lot of these logistical and ethical issues by replacing the chimpanzee part of this process with humanized mice. And this is the team that contributed towards that work. And we subsequently used this to get some large programmatic funding to do this at a really big scale. And this enabled us to go after crosses in a big way. So whereas previously we had, as I mentioned, about 4 genetic crosses previously that maxed out at 35 recombinant progeny, we've done 29 genetic crosses in the last few years. And some of these have absolutely kind of mind-blowing numbers of progeny. So 2 of the crosses are closing on 300 unique recombinant progeny, which means that the power and the precision that we can go after genetic mapping with really, really goes through the roof. We've also focused a lot on picking clinically relevant strains, so often drug-sensitive and drug-resistant strains, which are allowing us to go after subtleties about chloroquine resistance, which we previously were unanticipated. And we have a paper that's coming out, I believe, on BioArchive either today or in the next few days on identifying a new chloroquine resistance gene called AAT1. So for those of you who are unfamiliar with the process of genetic mapping, so here we have a description of the parasite genome. These are 2 parentals, one is blue, one is red, and that would be the equivalent of the start of a chromosome and the end of a chromosome. These get passed through a mosquito where they sexually recombine and reshuffle their genomes, and these are the examples of recombinant progeny. You can see that there is very few recombination breakpoints here. And essentially what you would do is you would take each one of these individual progeny, you would phenotype them some way, for instance, how drug resistant they are or the expression of a particular gene, and then use that phenotype in conjunction with the genotype data to determine which parts of the genome are determining that phenotype. So for instance, at this line here, you can see that these bottom half of parasites are all red, these top are all blue. These are the ones with the lower, let's say, drug resistance phenotype, and these are the ones with the higher drug resistance phenotype. So we know that there is a significant hit for that being the drug resistance locus. So in our humanized mice, we have to tackle certain issues here. For a start, they have both originally mice blood and mice livers. So the immune system is somewhat knocked down so that you're able to repopulate the mouse liver with a liver donor from a human. That essentially overtakes a lot of the mouse liver. We inject those either by mosquito bite or by direct inoculation of sporozoites. Sporozoites go to the liver, and when they're just about to burst out into the bloodstream, we also put in human red blood cells to support growth in the bloodstream. We can then transition those very, very quickly into in vitro culture, where we perform cloning of those parasites, and then sequencing and further phenotyping for genetic mapping. So the work I'm going to talk about today is going to be based around expression QTL mapping. This is essentially using the same approach to understand how we can explain which genes drive variation in gene expression. This could be either the magnitude of gene expression or shifts in the timing of gene expression through the cell cycle. So some previous work that came out of Mike Furtick's lab relatively recently showed that gene expression can be driven, or variation in gene expression could be driven by environmental changes, could be driven by different parasite genotypes, or also random processes. So they performed some very careful experimenting of repeatedly measuring the same parasite lines over time, and we're able to sort of partition this variation into these three different sources, and showed that there is actually a very large amount of the differentially expression that was between these two lines is driven by parasite genotype. So we have good reason to go after the genetics that underpins this variation. So eQTLs, for those of you that for which this is a new term, come in various different flavors. They can either be cis-acting eQTLs. This means that the genetic mutation that is driving the variation here is very close to the gene which is varying in expression. Or they can be trans-acting, which means that the mutation determining variation is very far away from the gene determining expression. And then there are some more subtle features of eQTL mapping when you have temporal data, like the parasite life cycle or different life cycle stages, where things may be inconsistently active across either different life cycle stages or different life cycle types. So for instance, it may be that you get a shift in gene expression in every single cell type, or there may be kind of more complex patterns where everything goes up in one cell type and down in the other, or other kind of complex conditional relationships as well. And I will use these as an example a little bit later on in the presentation. So we have some major issues within malaria in terms of being able to accurately map expression QTLs. Anybody who's worked with malaria parasite cultures knows that maintaining synchronicity and getting parasites to a specific stage in the life cycle is incredibly challenging, but this can really undermine a lot of gene expression profiling. Typically, we culture parasites of different genotypes in different culture flasks, or sometimes using different red blood cell donors and batches of media and all these kind of things. That has a dramatic impact on the gene expression of a parasite, where essentially you could measure the same parasite with a different red blood cell donor or culture type, and all of these things will lead to subtle or potentially dramatic differences in gene expression. It's inherently difficult to scale these processes. A lot of the gene expression profiling measures require relatively large volumes of parasites. The synchronization and sampling of these requires substantial amounts of labor. And it's nothing that you can really do at the scale of thousands of parasite lines, but that was really where we'd like to be at. So we were asking whether or not we can use single cell RNA sequencing to essentially solve all of these problems and do eQTL mapping in a single tube in a very kind of short, well-controlled experiment. So the approach that we took was borrowed from a paper that came out of Leonid Krugliak's lab, where essentially they did this very same approach that we will do using C. elegans worms. They generated large pools of recombinant worms. They dissociated all the cells, performed single cell RNA sequencing, inferred gene expression from each of these single cells, and then from the individual reads within these single cell RNA-seq, there is a known genetic variants. They have the sequence of these two parents, so they can genotype within single cell RNA-seq reads, particular mutations, so they can infer patterns of recombination that are specific to an individual cell. And that is exactly the process that we follow here. So as a proof of principle, which is the data that I will present today, we took 22 progeny from one of the early crosses that we had. We have fantastic data on these. We have full genome sequence. We have de novo references from each of these two parental lines. We know that they can grow. They've been phenotyped in a lot of other ways. They've also had gene expression profiles performed on these independently as well, but I won't talk about that data today. So we essentially took each of these lines, thawed them, grew them up, combined them, and then jointly grew them together for a few weeks, and then performed single cell RNA-seq, both on our pool of recombinant progeny and for each of the two parents as well. We were quite focused initially on making sure that our data was robust. In the pooled progeny, we can identify where we have mixed genotypes, where we have for an individual sequencing read, we can detect both variation from both of the parents at a single site. And we were quite stringent at throwing these cells out to make sure that we can infer the recombination breakpoints well. We set a threshold here. On the next slide, I'm going to talk a little bit through how we do that genotype inference. And often within single cell sequencing experiments, you end up with two cells that come from either different genotypes or different life cycle stages within a single droplet. And this can really, you know, screw things up in the analysis. So we wanted to get rid of these as well. And we got actually a relatively high doublet rate for our pooled progeny. So we were quite strict at throwing away a lot of cells here. For both the EQTL analysis here, and we perform things along pseudo time, which I'll explain in just a moment, we identified a lot of parasites that were male or female gametocytes. Here, I won't present that data. We're in the process of doing more detailed analyses on those independently. So this is how we do the inference of genotyping from single cell sequencing. Here are our two parental genotypes, our known progeny panels. When we perform single cell sequencing on these, we will get kind of sparse data where we might have a read that hits here that is from the blue parent, a read that hits over here from the red parent. And we can essentially just use a hidden Markov model that goes across and will switch between this parent or this parent at a rate that we determine previously, which matches how often we expect recombination between these two parent genotypes in the mosquito to arise, and gives us imputed genotypes at every single site that varies in the parasite genome. So we have about 10,000 SNPs which differ between NF54 and NHP4026. From each individual cell, we genotype somewhere between 150 and 800 SNPs after QC. And the first question we really wanted to know is, how good are we at doing this? Pretty good. For the data that goes into the inference, about 98% of those SNPs are correct because we can match these back to our known progeny genotypes. And then based on the imputation of markers, again, bear in mind, we're going from something like 150 markers to 10,000 markers. Around 87% of those are correct. And essentially where these are incorrect are at those points in the parasite genome where it switches from one parental genotype to the other one. And we can mitigate against this a lot by, rather than taking hard genotype calls, taking what's called genotype probabilities, which just builds in a level of confidence about how good we were about that genotype calling. So this is our data. I'm sure by this point, everyone is very familiar with seeing the parasite-like life cycle displayed on UMAP projections. To make things a little bit more complicated, it runs anti-clockwise on my presentation. So we've got rings that start up here. They come all the way around to schizons up here. And this pseudo time estimation is what we use to partition this into different life cycle stages. So we split this graph essentially into 12 pieces and did EQTL mapping for each of the 5,772 genes for which we have data independently. And that's our cutoff for significance. So this is what we found. So we found about 1,000 genes have an EQTL at some point throughout the parasite life cycle. You can see there is this, just to orientate you guys. This is gene expression across the bottom. And this is the location in the parasite genome up the top here. It's ever so slightly rescaled for those keen-eyed ones. It doesn't go up to 23 megabases. It's because we've slightly rescaled it here. So each of the chromosomes are in order going up here. But sadly, the slide that I chose to include here did not demarcate those. And I'm sorry for that. So you can see this big box up the middle. And there is a very clear pattern where you get a very, if you squint your eyes right, you will see a diagonal line of red dots that runs up there. And that is where we see a mutation changes the expression of the gene right next to the gene of interest. And everything else you see in these lines that go across are trans EQTLs where the mutation is not near the gene of interest. You can see, I hope, very clearly that there are a number of spots throughout the parasite genome where we see a lot of EQTLs. These are hotspots of variation where we see one gene or one variant controlling a lot of the gene expression differences genome-wide. This plot, again, apologies here for how busy this slide is. This is the LOD score profile, sorry, the number of hits any given marker had across each life cycle stage. So it goes from the earliest life cycle stages to the latest life cycle stages. So you can see here, this is chromosome 14. This particular EQTL hotspot is active essentially across the whole parasite, the intraerythrocytic parasite life cycle. Whereas there is one here on chromosome 12, which really kind of peaks midway through the life cycle and is not active at the end, likewise some stuff down here on chromosome 7. So we are seeing both kind of static and dynamic EQTLs that hit across this life cycle. So I'm just gonna display some very raw data across the whole life cycle stage. We have, again, about 1,000 genes overall that had at least one EQTL across at least one time point. There is an increase in the number of QTL stages that we see towards the end of the life cycle. We're trying to disentangle at this point whether or not this is a real biological phenomena or this is driven by other artifacts, such as the fact that you get higher quality data that comes from the later stages that are more transcriptionally active. What was quite interesting here, and I think is quite robust, is that cis EQTLs we saw to be relatively constant in number throughout the parasite life cycle. And most of this variation is driven by trans effects. And this is excess of trans effects is probably driven by those small number of hotspots that we see scattered throughout the parasite genome. I wanted to give you a little bit of a flavor of the different sorts of EQTLs that we saw coming up in this study. So for each of these plots, this is time across the x-axis. Apologies, this hasn't come across quite as clear as I thought it would do. The y-axis is gene expression. These are all cis acting, so where the mutation is right next to the gene of interest. And this is all just in progeny data. So this is, the blue is parasites that have the NHP4026 allele right next to the gene that we're looking at. The red is the NF54 allele. This is an 18S ribosomal RNA. You can see that across the entire life cycle, there is a shifted difference. Whereas if you look at some other genes here, so there's MPISB2, there is a very stage-specific difference. And my favorite example here is where we see a temporal shift in gene expression patterns, where for NF54, gene expression is shifted further right than in NHP4026. NHP4026 is from an area of emerging drug resistance in Southeast Asia. This gene is implicated by people in the audience as being involved in artemisinin drug resistance, though we know not much more than that at this point, but it certainly is something that I'm quite interested in following up on. So on the previous slide, I highlighted this 18S ribosomal array here. We actually see a very nice, clean, significant peak, surrounding the gene here. And we see the same peak arise for the other type A 18S ribosomal RNA that is present on chromosome 5, which might suggest kind of some joint control of ribosomal gene expression for these two genes. What we also want to do ultimately is to take other phenotypic data that we have and try and see how we can better understand potential mechanisms or prioritize genes for follow-up by integrating both eQTL data with other kind of QTL mapping data. This is an experiment that we did that should come out in this journal within a couple of days, I think, where we identified bits of the parasite genome that drive growth in albumax versus serum. And there is a few really big hits here. The first was chromosome 13, which we validated to be driven by EBA140. But there were a number where we didn't have great candidate genes. One of those was on chromosome 2. And one of the genes that had a significant cis eQTL under that was MSP2. Very excited seeing MSP2 presentations tomorrow, and we're going to follow up along that hopefully soon. So overall, I hope I have convinced you that we can do eQTL mapping with single-cell RNA-seq. We get good accuracy from our single-cell genotyping. Even using a relatively small and underpowered experiment, we can capture many, many more eQTLs than have previously been described. And that these eQTLs act in interesting and different ways on both the timing and the magnitude of expression. The skew towards trans eQTLs mirrors data put out by Mike Ferdig some time ago, so that is quite reassuring. And that we do see a lot of kind of eQTL hotspots probably driving this impact. And ultimately, what we hope to use is eQTL mapping as a way of both kind of understanding basic mechanisms of gene regulation, gene expression regulation in the parasite genome, and also to prioritize functional follow-up in other studies. So there's a huge, huge group of people involved in this who are all listed here, and we are currently funded programmatically through the NIH for this work. And thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you, Ian. That was an awesome talk. Any questions from the audience? So I'll start then. So you were using NF54 for all of the crosses that have been done so far, just kind of a weird African strain. Do you have plans to use other African parasites in the future?
So actually today we've used NF54 for a lot, but we've also focused on using some recent Malawian isolates, lots of other kind of Thai versus Thai or Thai versus Cambodian crosses as well. We have used NF54 because it's a great gametocyte producer and it behaves very well in Ashley Bourne's hands. So that that was more of a kind of a safety net for us. But yeah, we are thinking of expanding way beyond NF54 and essentially doing kind of crosses on anything that has phenotypes of interest.
Super cool.
Thanks for the talk. I was just wondering why you are focusing mainly on gene expression and not allelic variation, because it could be that your phenotype is impacted by change in gene expression, but also through change in allelic variation, like simple polymorphism.
Yeah.
And I'm just concerned, not concerned, my opinion is you might not see that signal that comes from the allelic variation if you're focusing on EQTL. And will you get a better picture if you are combining this with the genome-wide association study? And have you done that to just see whether you have a good correlation?
So great question. That gives me the opportunity to sort of highlight that. Actually, this is part of a much larger effort where we are predominantly focused on using genetic variation to understand things like differences in drug resistance. And we are focused predominantly on genetic variation. And this almost falls kind of below that. In once we have regions where, for instance, drug resistance kind of maps very, very tightly, we can then prioritize potential drug resistance genes or try and understand, you know, whether that is a kind of a local effect or it's impacting some indirectly throughout the genome to try and understand function as well as identifying things like drug resistance genes. So thank you very much.
Yes, and finally, also because we did similar work in mosquitoes, but this time we are focusing to get the QTL using the extreme phenotypes. For example, comparing highly resistant versus highly susceptible. And in that case, the signal of the QTL was stronger. Are you thinking of using something similar? Thank you.
Sorry, I'm not quite sure I understood the question.
Sorry. I was just saying that the strength of your genetic mapping approach may be stronger if you are actually comparing things which are very different.
I mean, I completely agree. And actually, a lot of the prioritization of the parental lines that we put into these genetic crosses are picked to be very sensitive versus very drug resistant, for instance.
Perfect.
Okay. Briefly, one is a technical question, just wondering why you divided the cycle into 12. And then secondarily, the big trans peaks presumably are regulators of some sort that have broader effects, and if you have anything to comment about those.
In terms of dividing the life cycle into 12, there wasn't a particularly strong...
I didn't know if it's a mathematical thing or if it's just you said 12. And we'll...
It was a convenient thing. And actually, okay. what I'm progressing towards is actually trying to simultaneously do kind of dynamic EQTL mapping where you're just taking pseudo time and mapping simultaneously across the whole life cycle. This was more, we needed to make some decisions about how to kind of proceed with these experiments. And 12 seems as good as anything else. You know, 4-hour time blocks is pretty reasonable in my view, but it was intuition rather than mathematical. Oh, and for the second question was...
Large,
chromosome 14. Yeah. It does, you know, it's a pretty broad peak. There are some APAP2 genes that fall under there that are potential regulators, but there's a lot of genes that fall under there. As we do kind of more and more of this, I think we're going to get tighter peaks when we have more recombinants than 22, and we'll be able to be more precise with our mapping. And I think once we hit there, we'll be able to tell whether or not this is one peak or multiple overlapping peaks, and whether this is one gene, multiple genes. We'll know a lot more hopefully next week when some more data comes back.
We're going to take a question actually online quickly.
Okay, Bryce Letcher is asking online, do you see any de novo mutations in the progeny that are also EQTLs?
That's a really good question. We have we do see de novo mutations in our progeny in general. They're about as common as you would expect based on the mutation rate. And we haven't really done much with those beyond trying to not use the parasites that have de novo mutations, especially big kind of structural rearrangements. downstream. So we try and mitigate against de novo mutations driving some of the findings we have by not using those that have certainly big chromosomal truncations.
My question was basically the same, but I was hoping you could use them. Do you think, like, the fact that you could get these in culture de novo, because you culture the parasites before you look at them, can tell you about their suitability or non-suitability for whichever phenotype you're looking for?
In terms of the de novo mutations that they may accrue throughout that time?
Yeah, say you have two like fresh-ish isolates you have crosses off, but none of them have these de novo mutations that then suddenly you find after culturing them. I know it's like a mix of GWAS crosses analysis. Like, can you detangle these effects and can they possibly tell you anything?
So there is another genetic cross I didn't talk about today, and this work I think is in process, where we have multi-drug resistant parasite lines that have amplifications surrounding plasmepsin genes. This is kind of well-established mutation that drives that. But when we passage them through the mosquito through a genetic cross, they lose this variation and they alter their response to piperaquine. So I think these sort of things, I think indirectly, we're using to go in the same kind of direction that you're thinking of here.
Very cool. Thank you, Ian.